Kate. Thank you.
Thanks, David. Hello, everyone. Welcome to this session looking at creative independence. My name's Kate McGrath. I'm director of Fuel, which is a UK-based independent production company, working mainly in live performance. We're building free, and we work with independent artists and freelancers to create new projects. So last year, Fuel's workforce consisted of 18 staff members and 323 freelancers. So since lockdown, we've been supporting that community, as well as initiating the freelance task force, which saw 150 arts organisations coming together to sponsor 169 freelancers to work together for 3 months, one day a week, strengthening the voice of freelancers in conversations about the current crisis and about the future recovery. So this conversation will be of great interest to those organisations and those freelancers. So I'm delighted the British Council asked me here to chair today's session. I'd like to introduce Ugo. Before I do that, I need to check that Ugo is here. Alison, do you know if Ugo is here?
Hello, yes. So I'm Alison, the arts manager working behind the scenes, not switching on my camera. And I'm just scrolling the list for Ugo, and maybe if he's in the chat he could say something. I see some colleagues of Ugo there, and I would suggest to Kate you just skip on and introduce Jean, and we'll see where Ugo's at.
Great, okay, maybe we can come back to Ugo. So now I'd like to invite creative director of the season, Jean Cameron, to say a few words.
Thanks, Kate. Buon pomeriggio a tutti. Un vero piacere avere l'opportunità di essere presente oggi con voi dalla mia casa a Glasgow, in Scozia, in Gran Bretagna. Good afternoon, everyone. As Kate said, I'm the creative director for this British Council season. I'm the first freelancer to work as creative director with British Council on one of their seasons, and I hope I'm not their last. It's been an incredible privilege to be working on this project for the last 20 months, and to have, in particular during these very challenging times, an opportunity such as today to engage with kindred spirits internationally through the power of this work. I think many of you know that the British Council builds connections and trust between people in the UK and other countries through education and culture and English language. What you might not know is that it has been working in Italy for over 70 years now, so a heritage to build on. The UK-Italy season 2020's theme is being present, and it comes at a time when the world is really reconsidering how we are present physically, virtually, how we are present with ourselves, and how we are present with other people. And I think when thinking about this, the sub themes within that, one of the things that really interests me is how in 2020 people are being present and voices are speaking up, not because they've been invited to, but because they've chosen to. And I think that's really important for this session with creative independence. It's a very, very precarious and dark moment for creative independence, as it is across the whole cultural sector, but there's a real articulation from our creative independence in Italy, in the UK, elsewhere, that the agency, representation and profile of what we bring to the fabric of our cultural sessions are incredibly necessary. And Ugo, who is our Italian host for today's event in Bergamo, talked to me about this session and told me that in Italy he considers the independence to be invisibile, invisible. So it's really important that we have a session that brings the independence present today. And I'd like also to thank Gaia De Lorenzo, who is one of the panelists on this call, for representing creative independence for the last 18 months on our programme board for this season, and for pushing for the visibility and place of the independence and bilateral projects such as this. The cultural salon today is a new experiment for British Council Italy, and we really, really want to know if we're getting it right. So you will be encouraged to fill in a questionnaire at the end of this season. And again, on social media, I really encourage you to use our hashtag UKItaly2020, hashtag being present, to engage with us. You know, we were talking just now about doing cultural relations digitally, and is that useful? What does that mean for you? British Council are really keen to know. This is the first of three cultural salons during the season, starting with Creative Independence today. Then on the 19th of October, a session on cities, festivals and resilience. And then on the 5th of November, the final salon in the season is looking at infrastructure and new business models. So your contributions, your presence is really, really valuable in all of these. Thank you. Thanks, Kate.
Thanks very much, Jean. Now we've got some really fantastic panelists, and there's also clearly lots of really, really interesting attendees as well. So let's get stuck into this conversation. Our panel will be exploring the opportunities and challenges of being a creative independent in these times, in order to identify common issues, shared concerns, and also to interrogate what is needed to underpin the sustainability of independence as a vital part of our cultural ecology. We're going to do that by seeking to look at three questions. The first is, how have creative independents connected and collaborated in new ways since the crisis? The second is, how has the relationship between creative independence and the wider sector, both with organisations and at policy level, changed since the COVID crisis? And the third is, as we look to the future, how can creative independence be more visible and more present? So I'm delighted to introduce the panellists. We have with us, and maybe you can give a little wave, Julie Lomax, who joined AN, the Artists Information Company, as CEO in 2018. AN is the largest artist membership organisation in the UK, with over 25,000 members. Its mission is to stimulate and support contemporary visual arts practice and affirm the value of artists in society. Welcome, Julie. Paolo Montemuro is director of Matera Hub, a project manager of EU-funded projects and working on capacity building actions for the sector, with a focus on economic sustainability, internationalisation and cross-fertilisation. He's currently working as a technical expert on new support programmes for the creative industries. Welcome, Paolo. Ryan Hughes is an artist and curator interested in collaboration and what was briefly called the post-internet. He founded and is artistic director of Coventry Biennial, an artist-led social, political and critical platform for contemporary art. The third Coventry Biennial, called Hyper Possible, takes place in 2021 as part of UK City of Culture. Thanks for being here, Ryan. Linda Di Pietro is Chief Cultural Officer of Base Milano. She is co-founder of Lo Stato dei Luoghi, forgive my accent, Linda can correct me, a cultural regeneration network. In 2007, she founded Interdisciplinarte, a cultural development company which coordinated the programming and services of the former factory, CAOS, Art Centre in Terni, and was cultural manager of Manifattura Tabacci in Cagliari. Thank you for joining us, Linda.
Thank you.
Matthew Goff is a dance artist, dramaturg, and a lecturer based in Cardiff. Their practice spans improvisation, contemporary dance, screen dance, physical theatre, art in public spaces, and theatre for young audiences. Matt is a senior lecturer at the University of South Wales. Thanks for being here, Matt. Gaia Di Lorenza and Lucrezia Calabro Visconti are joining us together today. Gaia is an artist and the founder of Castro, an artist-run free education program based in Rome. Lucrezia is a curator based in Turin. They are both members of Arts Workers Italia, an informal advocacy group for arts workers in Italy, operating with a local and transnational perspective. Thank you both for being here. I'm really keen to get stuck into the first question. So I'd like to first invite Paolo and then Matt to respond to that. I'm going to repeat the question so that you in the audience attending the webinar can think about it and post any questions that you have. And we will try to respond to those after the panelists have had a chance to share some ideas. So, how have creative independents connected and collaborated in new ways since the crisis? Paolo, would you like to kick us off?
Thank you very much, Kate, and good afternoon, everyone. Connecting to what Jane was saying before, I think that what we experienced in the last couple of months was an attempt by creative professionals and independent to becoming visible by working together and by joining forces together. We have experienced both at local, national, and European level a tendency of people working in the cultural and creative sector, independent freelancer, to try and join forces because they started to realize that they have probably in the previous time before COVID never thought really of themselves outside the artistic practices. So they started to understand their importance as workers, the need to join strengths and work in networks. And this not only at national level or local level, but also in the European dimension. Because for the first time, what the sector was facing was not a national challenge, was not a local challenge, it was a global challenge. So this was somehow connecting everyone everywhere in Europe. And in this, we witnessed two main things, a great exercise of awareness raising in the sector, and an exercise of giving visibility to what was happening in the different sectors and in the different part of our country in Italy, but also in Europe. In the projects and in the professionals that we have been following, there are two very interesting examples that I'm happy to share. The first one was and is still running at European level, and it's the Creative Unite platform, which is a platform promoted by European Commission, by the Creative Europe Programme, that is trying to collect all the way, the different ways, the different projects that professionals from arts, culture, and the creative sector have put in practice in order to react or restart after the COVID pandemic in reaction to the COVID pandemic. And it's very useful because it is a way to open further cooperation to other professionals from other parts of Europe which are potentially interested in getting those experiences and applying at local level. The second examples that I want to bring is very interesting, and it's very connected to the local dimension. We are based in Matera. Matera last year was European Capital of Culture. In Matera, 2020, that should have been the legacy here, had a really severe impact because everything stopped. But what didn't stop was the will of the professionals, in the cultural professionals in Matera, to think of themselves inside a wider network. So they have been working in the past couple of months in order to build a new network which will connect artists, independent artists, from the European Capital of Culture, which is something that doesn't exist, and it's something that normally is not at the center of European Capital of Culture, because normally there are intermediary organizations which run the events and take care then of bringing in the artist. And another element that I wanted to add in conclusion is also that for the first time, there was a structured approach towards seeing cultural professional artists to really think of themselves into other sectors. So we have seen a pilot project of artists to think of themselves as innovators in the current crisis time, as part of the solution to the challenges that we are living, not as one sector to be supported. And this we have seen as a tendency with artists that are working and cooperating with companies, artists that are working and cooperating with the public sector and with the local communities. So this is what I think it will be good to share today with everyone. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Paolo. Matt, can I pass over to you to share some thoughts on this first question?
Thank you, and hello, everyone. So I'd agree with Paolo. I think there's been a real coming together of people to recognize that arts is work, but also that the artists are a part of a wider society. And so people, yes, are coming together to give voice to their concerns about things before and during the COVID pandemic that they might not have otherwise spoken about. So working conditions, working hours, pay, and so on and so forth, and not really being a part of the systems which decide what happens in funding. So we see groups like was mentioned before, the Fuel Freelance Task Force, where freelancers are being paid to sit at the table with organisations and join those conversations. And I think that had a real groundswell of movement. In Wales, we've had a range of both the formal freelance task force and some independent task forces set up that have been engaging with Arts Council Wales, with Welsh Government, with various organisations to meet, to talk, to consider what conditions are there. And that's felt hugely important. However, the issue within that is that what we are seeing is that elements of these task forces and these new conversations are perpetuating and extending the exclusion that happens. So we know that people from Black and non-Black people of colour and disabled people are suffering from COVID extensively, and they've often been not present in the arts sector and the cultural sector at all. And in some of the new associations, we're seeing those voices continue to be excluded. So what's been really interesting is movements such as We Shall Not Be Removed, which is a disabled campaign about thinking about the impact of COVID on disability in general, but also the impact it has on freelance artists in terms of the risk you have of returning to work, in terms of the conditions that you might be working under, and then the general exclusion of non-white people. Because if we think about it, what are we looking at? We're looking at white ableist organizations who are struggling under COVID and saying, you need to help us, you need to change the systems so we can continue to do our work and be included. And that change hasn't been afforded to other people. So I think it's been really interesting to see that people and artists and freelancers are very much saying, recognize us as individuals and our cultural context, as well as us as artists. And let's think of a different way of engaging. So I think one of the really important things that is maybe the positive shifts is that people working together who haven't worked before, and in a much more democratic and equal way. And that's imperative, because we are all in this together. And we haven't all been present at the table with our voices. And so the new connections have been of significant importance, where organizations are admitting where they've been culpable, be it low wages, be it they're putting contracts at short notice, and that the discussion has become much more a two-way conversation of how we can work together, because the voice and the labour of freelancers is being recognised for its absolute importance. That without that freelance economy, without the economy, without the disabled economy, without the black and non-black people of color economy, we couldn't do the work we need to do. And certainly in the places where there is government level funding, we need that diversity, because arts and culture are being funded for everyone, not the privileged few. So I think for me, that's been the interesting shift, that it's not just about what we make, but who we are. Recognizing our work and making significant shifts towards change.
Thank you, Matt. And really interesting to hear you highlight different methods and types of conversation, different kinds of dialogues happening. I'd like to just open this question up for any comments from the rest of the panel. And just to flag up to attendees, please do use the Q&A function to pop any questions that you have related to this first area of the conversation in there. But just to open up to Ryan and Linda, Lucrezia and Gaia, anything you'd like to comment on or add to from what you've heard? Wow, I think Paolo and Matt, you've covered it. You've covered everything that's happened since the beginning of the COVID crisis so eloquently. I think it's interesting. We knew this would happen, didn't we? But Matt, you've touched on some of the second area that we're going to move on to, specifically in terms of the relationship between creative independence or freelancers and organisations, and how that dialogue is shifting, and perhaps the spotlight of COVID has accelerated a much overdue shift in that conversation. I wonder, Italian colleagues, whether you're finding that creative independents are coming together in the sort of ways or in different ways that Matthew's described in terms of these associations, task forces. Is there a difference in the way that you're seeing those groups form, or is there a real echo there? Lucrezia, can I come to you on that one?
Absolutely. I think actually first of all, thank you everybody for having us here as Art Workers Italia. But I feel like what Matteo was saying really resonated with a lot of thinking that we have been doing in Art Workers Italia, especially in the past months, since any kind of organization right now cannot be think without, you know, acknowledging the general situation of violence and, you know, uprising that has been brought up in the past months. So thinking about striking, thinking about, you know, pressing policymakers really goes back to thinking through and together with marginalized communities. So I think what is specific about Art Workers Italia is that it was born really from a grassroots need of supporting, like creating a solidarity network in between people in need during COVID. And it was born out of a Facebook group. So I don't know if Facebook can be said as a, I don't want to do, you know, sponsor this, absolutely not. But the fact is that it was really something very spontaneous, and it's now that we are actually developing that in something more structured, because of course what COVID shows is actually structural problems that are inside our system since so long, and that now needs to be addressed because there is no other option right now. So in this sense, this is something that is always in our mind, and also in the manifesto that we wrote, I think it's something that really resonated with a lot of people. The fact, the will of thinking not only about art workers, but first of all, as precarious workers. And so to be really trans professional, but it's really more like what is our way of living right now, and so with whom we feel accustomed to. So our thinking is definitely in this direction.
Really interesting, and it also reminds me of some of the conversations I've had with Jean, which Matthew's comments also connect with in terms of the place of care in the conversations that creative independents have been having. Matt talked about creative independence as artists and workers, but also as people, and I think a lot of the learning from the freelance task force has been about process and access and inclusion as much as it has been about outputs. And I wonder, Jean, I don't know whether you want to comment at all on that question that you've been thinking about in the idea of being present and where care comes into the conversations between creative independents at this time.
Yeah, thanks, Kate. I think it is, you know, at a very basic level, when being present, the opportunity and the tension in being present 24/7 being present and connected can be a great thing. It can be something that feels fortifying, but can also be a real pressure. And as a freelancer working across multiple projects, if you're lucky, and being responsive to organisations and institutions, you know, there's often an expectation around being present and availability, which really jars with how you can be present as a caregiver and taking care of yourself.
Thank you. At the moment, I don't have any questions from attendees. So I just want to ask whether anyone else on the panel wants to pick up on anything that the rest of the panel have introduced here, Matt.
I think there is a question maybe in the chat, which is how do we progress these conversations to productions? You.
Yes, sorry, it's in the chat rather than the Q&A. Thanks for flagging that up. Yes, how do we progress those conversations to productions when the second lockdown happens? And how do we financially support independents and freelancers? So a question looking at where we go next with this. Matt, do you want to start? And then Gaia, maybe I'll come to you.
Yeah, I think actually it's really important that we see these conversations as a starting point. So I understand like the fuel task force, that the payment for those individuals has stopped now, but that shouldn't be the end of the conversation. I think everyone needs to recognize we've simply begun a process of change, and actually engaging in that conversation long-term will help negotiate the differences, but will lead to the productions themselves. I think, you know, the more we speak with other, the more we understand new options and new opportunities, especially the people that we haven't worked with. And so actually, I think as long as we keep talking, the productions and opportunities will reveal themselves. As soon as we set up a structure where we're like, we're done with this moment of crisis, let's return back to working, I think we just risk falling back into the same patterns.
Thanks. And it's interesting just reflecting on that process with the freelance task force. We're in a moment of breath and evaluation and learning from that initial first phase. And the task force members were very clear, I think, about the need for us to take a moment. The task force came together very quickly in a moment of crisis to try and make sure that freelancers had a voice in those conversations. And, you know, with speed comes inevitably mistakes and issues along the way. And so taking this moment, as you say, Matthew, to kind of work out how that conversation continues in a way that learns from and embeds everything that's come out of the first few months feels really important. Gaia, over to you.
I thought this question was particularly interesting, as the first lockdown felt like a national thing, at least for us, as we were. So it happened before in Italy, so it felt like something that was mainly that we could speak between, you know, workers in Italy. Now, if a second should happen, or anyways, from now on, it feels like at least a European or a global situation. Therefore, what I think will be interesting is to expand the conversation between independents, between freelancers, which is what we're doing right now, but to continue doing that in time. So to come together, not only as, you know, workers from one part of the world, but as art workers and independents, you know, globally. So I thought that was really interesting question.
That's right. And I wonder if anyone has any examples of other connections. This feels like a really great opportunity to connect beyond those national boundaries that we've all been thinking in these last few months. But I think it would be really great to explore, and the British Council definitely has a role to play here in terms of how those conversations might join up and what connections could be made between these different initiatives and groups and associations, and how we can share learning. I don't know if there are any other examples that people have of that kind of international connectivity at this time. It does feel, Gaia, listening to you, that we have been quite national in our focus during this crisis. Has everybody else felt that as well, or have you had opportunities to connect internationally? Julie, over to you.
We're actually what is called an artists association, and why I think as well that this is quite pertinent as to this particular conversation is we're part of something called the International Arts Association, which is affiliated to UNESCO. And it came out of a UNESCO inquiry in 1948. And the first president of the International Arts Association was actually an Italian futurist artist, Gino Severini. And the International Arts Association was set up out of a meeting in Venice, which would have been a Venice Biennale year. And I think what's important is, because it's linked to UNESCO, it's linked to the rights of the artists, and UNESCO really wanted to make sure that artists were a real part of their work and how working. It still continues to this day, and we're the UK representative in this organisation, but it's also a global organisation. And only this week I have been doing some work. I did a talk for the Daiwa Foundation, and there's an international arts association member in Japan. And so we've been able to keep the connections, because this is an organization with a history. The thing that has come into focus for all the associations that are part of that organization is, of course, the rights of the artists in this particular time. It's been really interesting to continue those conversations and how we can work on programs globally to keep artists and artists' rights and the idea of the artist as an art worker in the forefront of policymakers.
Thanks, Julie. And I'm noticing there is a question in the Q&A. Around creative networks, perhaps like yours, but in Italy, if they exist, and also if they're supporting creative independence, and whether those types of creative networks are being funded by the government or supported by the government, as they are in some cases beginning to be in the UK. I wonder if one of our Italian colleagues might be able to answer that. And it will lead us into the next question. So I think we could take that question now. Paolo, great.
Yeah, of course, I will leave to Linda maybe talk about Lo Stato dei Luoghi, which is one of the new networks created in Italy. But yeah, there are some grassroots aggregation of freelancer and professional, but the connection with the, let's call them policymakers or government, like the one that we can see in UK are actually missing. So what you can find is Italian organization or Italian freelancer belonging to European networks already. There is never like the national connection. It's immediately a more European one that helped the sector in this way.
Thanks. That's very interesting hearing you talk about there being more European rather than national networks, whilst reading in the chat a fear from Rebecca Gould about in a more inward looking domestic focus in the UK heightening in Wales and Scotland with national elections, and then also the focus on leaving the EU. We're in a different place, maybe in some senses. I'm going to move on to question two, which feels very related to this, which is really touching on this relationship both with organisations, which Matthew touched on, and with the government and policy, as some of the questions are starting to raise. Ryan and Linda, I'm going to come to you first on this one. How has the relationship between creative independence and the wider sector, both with organisations and also at policy level, changed, do you think, since that crisis? Ryan, I'll come to you first.
Thanks. Hi, everybody. So I just want to start by saying perhaps that working from the West Midlands in the UK, our situation is perhaps a little different to the national picture in that we're in this sort of mega cultural moment, in that we've got UK City of Culture here in Coventry next year. So it was really interesting to hear from Paolo about being in that legacy from the Capital of Culture moment, when we're just actually building up to that sort of City of Culture piece. But then also the following year from City of Culture, also in the region, we've got the Commonwealth Games and the cultural festival that comes along with that. So actually, I feel like our policy, organisational and independent sort of position is very different to the rest of the UK. So it just felt important to highlight that at the start here. And also to highlight actually at the policy level, the work that we do on Coventry Biennial, of course, engages with policy, but we're in no means writing or sort of delivering against it directly. So just observationally, I think we've seen much more engagement between freelancers and artists and policy, and certainly perhaps just a deeper engagement with that. And I think an example has been at the start of the lockdowns, we saw just a huge amount of surveys. And that, for me, that very much felt like organisations taking this moment to actually listen to the sector, to listen to freelancers and artists. And then once that listening had happened, there was the opportunity to really drive that forwards and to actually lobby and report to government with factual information and with actual agency from the sector. And then, of course, with the relationship between freelancers, artists and organisations, that there's been a really mixed response. I didn't want to sort of skip past the fact we're seeing huge amounts of redundancies across the sector. But again, in the West Midlands at the moment, we have seen a huge amount of support from organisations for freelancers and artists. And in fact, Carol from the audience's second question that we didn't address around how do we financially support artists and freelancers is something we asked ourselves at the very start of lockdown. And it sort of drove the way forward with the work we're doing on Coventry Biennial throughout the period, and it's still ongoing. And really for us, that unfolded with us delivering our programmes, or parts of our programmes, earlier than we were anticipating. And so our real sort of response to that question of how do we support freelancers was we employ them. And actually we just start offering work earlier than we thought we would. And that enables us to engage with not just freelancers, but audience. And so, yeah, we employed artists, designers, writers, front of house staff, and we started to deliver activity in, in whatever way we could in this new normal. And I think that brings me to, I think I've covered.
Thanks, Ryan. It's probably useful to share that the government here have just announced an extension to the income support scheme for the self-employed, which offers 20% of people's earnings. And it's also fair to say that a huge number of freelance workers are not eligible to receive support from that scheme. So where there is government support, there are some really significant problems with the amount of money and whether people are eligible or not at present. Linda, I'm going to come to you on this question.
Yeah, thanks a lot. It's been a very interesting conversation up to now. I represent BASE, so a creative hub in Milano. We host many creative people in our co-working project house, almost 100 years, last year especially, some of them on an annual basis and some others on a daily basis. And we also host us artists in residence. At the same time, I represent Lo Stato dei Luoghi, as Paolo mentioned before, which is the first network of cultural centers born from urban regeneration in Italy, and is born during the lockdown. So during the lockdown, we decided to gather the forces and to get together to ask for more recognition for these creative hubs that are representing the freelancers, creatives, and artists that work within them. Creative hubs and cultural centers have been the first ones to start back working, to function as places to replace also the public utility functions that were closed during the lockdown. Because they are located in neighborhoods, they operate already in proximity, they are very widespread from small cities to big cities. In Italy, they are really scattered all over the country. And they used to host very different activities. So they have become, when the traditional institutions have closed, when all the public places have closed, and they were still closed, these hubs opened back to creative people, to freelancers, and to citizens as well. And together, creatives and citizens had the chance to co-design the spaces, to co-decide on the processes of getting back together, to make the audience aware of the recommendations of experts in connection with the conditions of the rules, the new rules we were forced to live in. And together, thanks to these places that were free places to co-design, we invented a new way of fruition, of cultural fruition. The point for me is, in fact, to involve at the same time artists and citizens in the decision-making processes. Also, Matt said this before. How much, how long to return to share in a normal way the ritual of culture? We have to co-participate in this process. Considering the Italian government during the lockdown, it was the first time actually that independents have been rewarded with a fixed salary for 3 months. It is a very low amount. It's been 600 euros. But it is a start, because it was the first time that artists have been recognized as political category since many years. And it was also the first time that women took the lead of artists and creative people movements. You see how many women you have here in this panel. And it was the first time in our country, in a country like Italy, that a movement of artists and freelancers like artist workers, like Gaia and Lucrezia represent. Or I also thought when Kate, you asked about other connections and gatherings of this group called Il Campo Innocente, which is a group of performing artists in Italy. They took the floor and said, we don't want to restart like this. we don't want to the visibility as a reward anymore. And they started making very radical questions. How many not white colleagues do you have? How many Italian not white curators do you know? So these kind of questions have never been raised in Italy before. So there is evidence that many movements have been born in these times, and they already intertwine, they already connect to each other, but they don't get any money from the public government. We as Lo Stato dei Luoghi have started a movement of pressure and lobbying to support freelancers, to use the creative hubs as places to host their work and to help supporting their work. I just finished with a couple of issues that I want to put on a table. I think that to pass over these unprecedented times, we have to keep lobbying for creative practitioners, opening, as Matt said, the funding organizations' tables, decolonizing them, sharing power, sharing decision making. Then the second point is a new alliance between independent organizations and government for visibility and support, opening a real conversation on collective agency, on collective resistance. And eventually I think that we should set up like a serious and not ideological conversation on basic income, on global basic income, which is probably something that we at certain point as to become the conversation. Thank you.
Thank you, Linda. Lots to talk about in there, and lots of questions that have been coming up in the UK resonating there in terms of continued lobbying, decolonizing, co-creating with communities. And this question of the redistribution or the possibility of the redistribution of government funding, which is very centralized on national institutions to creative hubs, as you call them in Italy. In the UK, there have been many conversations about how communities and artists can be funded directly and in different ways. Thank you both. I want to ask, first of all, the other panelists, would anyone like to come in on any of the last few minutes of this conversation, this question of the relationship between creative independence and organisations and the government? What's changing? What's shifting? What are the possibilities? Lucrezia?
I feel like there is one element that maybe we could add to the conversation in this sense to make it more like adhere to reality, which is, of course, for example, in the case of Italy, there was a starting point in recognizing independent work since, as Linda rightly said, there has been like a sort of recognition. But at the same time, we really need to address the fact that a lot of people were not eligible for that funding. So there really is not a VAT number that represents our curatorial practice or artistic practice, which really resonates to what you, Kate, was saying just before about, you know, eligibility within the scheme of the funding during the lockdown, and which brings me just to this topic, which is illegal workers. There is it's a really delicate topic, but I, at the same time, I feel like it's really necessary to bring it up, not only in terms of like how you don't have any rights while you are an illegal worker, but also you cannot be counted. So it's really hard to tell how many people, no, are in that situation, which is something that I just wanted to bring up to like remember that there is a big branch, let's say, of workers, which is illegal workers and cannot really be fit even into the numbers when we talk about art workers.
Absolutely, resonating with Ryan talking about redundancies and Matthew mentioning we shall not be removed. And there's also in the UK, Excluded UK, which is looking at some of those questions, Lucrezia, of who is not being counted, who's not part of the conversation. We did have a question in the chat for Julie from Margarita about how you see freelance artists participating in these conversations. And I wonder whether you might answer that question, Julie, also thinking about who's not being included, who has not historically been part of these conversations, and how is that shifting, or might that need to shift?
Hi, yeah, thank you for the question. I mean, it's very interesting, isn't it? Because what tends to happen, I think, in the UK, and I'm specifically speaking for visual arts, is that actually, and I'm sure it's the same in the other art forms, is that the institutions have to take precedent when it comes to conversations about infrastructure development, and also to be in receipt of funding as well. But from my experience, and I used to work at Arts Council England for nearly 10 years, and then I went off and worked in Australia, again in a similar role. In my experience, actually, it's a really low risk to give individuals money. It's a totally low risk situation. Whereas actually it's much more riskier to give funding to institutions. But because you know, the infrastructure has to be propped up, and quite rightly so, because artists do need places to show their work. That's where the money goes to. So again, coming back to the question, which is about how do individuals actually then become engaged in institutions? We have a program which is around artists as leader, and it's about putting artists in and artists making change, and it's about putting artists in every section of that. Cultural infrastructure, and also infrastructure in localities. And this is very important, because we don't see that there will be change, or that artists will get into those conversations, until we actually kind of really force ourselves in. And that's we can commodify it in terms of our business plan around artists as leader, artists make change. But literally, behind the scenes, what we're doing is we're saying artists need to be here, and we are going to force our way in. But of course, you know, you do need to understand how the infrastructure works in the first place.
Thanks, Julie. We've got some really fantastic questions coming in. Several of which are about the future. So we're going to move on to the third question, which starts pointing us that in that direction, and I'll pick up those questions. The question we wanted to ask was, as we look to the future, how can creative independence be more visible and more present? I just want to mention the questions in the chat in case you want to feed in any thoughts on them in your answers. There's a question, who is willing to move aside so creative freelancers can be decision makers about their own future? How do we have this conversation without it being combative? And a follow-up question from Emma Jane Park, who was on the freelance task force in the UK, in fact, asking, are those who are currently leaders willing to step aside or admit ignorance and learn from people who have successfully been using processes of co-design, consensus decision-making, and genuine community building? How can we promote this as a successful leadership strategy instead of perceiving it as a failure? So as we look to the future, how can creative independence be more visible and more present? And might some people need to move aside for that to be possible? I'm going to come to Gaia and Lucrezia first, if that's all right, and then I'll come to you, Julia.
Yes, I'm gonna quickly start and then leave it to Gaia. We will be very quick in this. Well, actually, there are so many interesting questions that I feel like it's a pity to continue with what we were planning to say. But I think one of the answers that Artworkers Italia gave to itself after these few months of operational, you know, practice is to unionize, not in the terms of a union, but in getting together, thinking together and acting together with a transnational scope, of course. And in this sense, we are kind of a case study for what Paolo was saying before in terms of the difference between local funding, for example, and European funding. In terms that we want, for example, the way in which we will sustain our practice in the next few months is through European Cultural Foundation with a grant that we won, which is anyways, you know, not obviously the best way to sustain yourself because it's project-based. So it's something that we're actually fighting against in terms of being considered as worker and not as something, someone that does a project and then gets funding for that project, but then cannot survive for the next year. So, but at the same time, it's really beautiful because it was a project that really born out naturally from the fact that after we published our manifesto on May 1st, we were contacted by so many groups of art workers from around the world, from Russia to Colombia to Greece. Cultural Workers Alliance Greece is basically a twin organization of Art Workers Italia in Greece. So very naturally, we came up to understand that we really needed to build a network of workers in art so that we could, you know, accept and work within the policies that are made locally, but think strategically with a collective vision that needs to be wider than that and needs to be there to you know, achieve ethical change, because that's also something that is maybe a word that we need to put on the table, because it has been into Art Workers Italia's discourses for since the beginning, actually, which is working on ethical change, first of all, and then, of course, building up tools that can be useful for everybody to achieve that and to policymakers to achieve that. So I really see that as a transition, not necessarily as finding leaderless organizations, but like learning together how to build a better system, definitely. And I'll leave it to Gaia. But before, I would also like to say that the manifesto is... you can sign our manifesto, which is something that we started, you know, doing in the last month, and that's also something that gives visibility to this kind of organization. Just showing up the fact that there's so many people thinking this or supporting this kind of thinking, counting ourselves and see the names beneath the manifesto is something really important. So I will just invite you to do that, and I leave it to Gaia. Thank you.
Yes, I might pick up on that. I think that what brought us to deciding to ask people to sign the manifesto is because we realized something that we in the culture sector we're not used to, that fragmentation is maybe not the richness that it usually is right now, that we have to look at the common ground rather than do many initiatives that are trying to do the same thing, but each count, divide the number of participants between themselves. So we started 6 months ago. We decided to structure ourselves through working tables, so dividing the work we wanted to do. And then now, after 6 months, we realized we need to know who we are. So we need to know what our individual needs are and decide to prioritize one question or another suggestion. So picking up on what Lucrezia was saying, this signing manifesto moment is exactly this. We've worked, we've talked on Zoom, but now we need to make sure that we're taking everyone's point of view in consideration. And that's a little bit what our signing the manifesto is, but also what we're gonna do after we've had this signing moment, which will be a survey moment. The people who have signed, we'll ask them what their needs are, how they're feeling. And here I tap into what Jean was talking about and Kate about care. So trying to consider individual people rather than a global community, but at the same time trying to bring together the general the most general needs. And one last thing I want to say on this question is, I think that what we are doing here and the bridge we are making between UK and Italy right now is extremely important, because it goes, it doesn't take into account what is happening. I mean, it does, but it goes over what is happening politically. And I think that is something that should, we should continue doing, because it is us who can make suggestions, and we're stronger if we're all together. So I'm really grateful for this event, and I do hope you'll help us bring forward the Art Workers Italia surveys and tests.
Thank you both very much. And there is a link in the chat for anyone who would like to read the manifesto and sign up, so please do take a look at that. Julie, over to you.
Hi, so I did prepare something. I think I'm still going to do it because I still think it's relevant, especially as the words that I came up with when thinking about this question were advocacy, change and care, and also another word, choice. So just to give you a little bit of information about AN, we're actually 40 years old this year. We were set up by a group of artists, and originally it was a newsletter. So the A and the N stands for Artist Newsletter. And the DNA of the organisation is artist-led and artists helping out other artists. So we fast forward 40 years and we find ourselves in this situation of a global pandemic. And one of the first things that we did was we did a survey, and we did this very early. So our survey was open, it was live between the 19th and the 24th of March. We had over 4,000 returns, and we had 93%, and this was when social distancing was in place in the UK, not full lockdown. And we actually had 93% of our respondents said their practice or their career had been affected. 96% said there was an impact on their income, and 82% had work cancelled, with people having work, you know, lots of work cancelled overnight. And I could see Ryan nodding his head because he knows what's happened. What was useful about doing this survey, it didn't really tell us anything that we didn't know, but it was useful in terms of formulating what we think are, what our next steps were. It was also useful in us being able to negotiate just under £2 million for artists and freelancers who are working in the visual arts. And we gave that out through two funds. One was called Time Space Money, and that was more about development and practice, and also the Freelance Foundation Emergency Fund, which was really about hardship funds. And in that time, we actually, in less than 4 months, we actually had 6,940 applications. To put that into perspective, Arts Council England across all the art forms had just over 10,000 applications. And we were able to process these really quickly because we had things in place. And so you may say, what does that mean? What you know, why are you telling me about a funding, a survey and a funding program? Actually, the two things when they came together gave us as an organization a lot of intelligence about individuals. So individuals, when they wrote what they needed through their applications or what they told us through the survey. And one of those things is it was became very clear about all the precarious business models that were in the sector. There has been some talk, Kate, you talked about the self-employment scheme with artists in particular, and I'm sure it's the same in your sector. They have portfolio careers, so they may do a bit of teaching, They may make some sales from their work. They have exhibitions, commissions. They may work in communities. They may do education work. So they have these portfolio careers. And that's a great way of sustaining your practice and doing the things that you want to do, and also working in a way that works for your practice. However, what it didn't do when it came down to the actual money is it didn't allow you to be furloughed from your job, because your job was probably only a few hours, maybe sometimes a week or even a term if you were teaching. And also your self-employment earnings were not high enough to be able to claim the self-employment money. But in addition to that, different business models meant that different artists were not able to claim any funding whatsoever. And it started me to think about how can we as an organization work better with artists, with creative independents, to look at business models, and how do we start to change the way that people actually think of a business model and think about it actually stemming from their work, as opposed to, I think I need to be a company, or maybe I need to be self-employment. So actually to start that thinking and to create the kind of way of operating in the world that you want to operate, which actually relates back to your practice. And the other element that made me think about this is one of the things that really perplexed me in the beginning of the whole COVID-19 global pandemic was this rush, this kind of mad scramble for institutions to remain relevant, and wanting artists to respond with online content and online work. And it was all suddenly digital and online. And there was this institutional mourning. I'd open my Instagram account and, you know, it would be, I don't know, LACMA wanting artists to do this. You know, all over the world, this was happening without actually a thought of, what about the artist and their practice? Does that practice actually translate or transfer into this digital realm? And also, you know, why is the institution making those kind of demands on their artists? And so that also perplexed me. And it did make me think that we actually do need to be able to do much more bespoke information, work, care with artists that actually stems from their practice. It really starts to think of, this is what I do, and this is how I make my work, and then actually use that as the starting point in terms of building then all of that professional development and how they might interact with institutions around that. I was going to say something about leadership, but I've managed to say that in the other question. So I'll wrap it up there.
Thanks very much, Julie. There's a call for you to share that data from that survey in the chat if you can. That would be really fantastic for people to be able to access. We've heard a lot about the plurality, the need for the plurality of voices, for bespoke approaches and different ways of being present and being visible and being heard. And in particular about those who've been systemically excluded from the conversation in various different ways. And perhaps what we're hearing is that the next stage from here is around how those surveys and manifestos, those conversations can continue, can include everyone, and can reach policy level to start achieving change. I'd like to at this point ask Ugo, who has now joined us, if he might say a few words, because part of what he's working on is exactly that. Ugo, can you join us?
Hello, can you hear?
Great, yes, we can.
Okay, it's worth, I'm sorry it was difficult to connect earlier. I will be very shortly, but it works perfectly to have a short word now, because I am, as you probably can see, in the city hall of Bergamo, where in 15 minutes we will start an art lab session on the issue which is absolutely linked to the debate you are just that is just over. And it's about the recognition of cultural profession. It will be a meeting attended by the president of the Cultural and Labor Committee of Senate and Chamber of Deputies, by the government, and by the president of IMSS, which is the agency, the national agency dealing with the social security and so on. And what we will do, the purpose of the meeting is to a joint commitment of the parliament, the government, and the IMSS to quickly work on the recognition of cultural professionals. And I think that the link, the missing link, and it was already mentioned by Paolo Montemuro and others in the conversation, is to link the independent networks of creative independence with the institutional level. Because if there is not a formal recognition of the value, the social, the value in terms of social cohesion, in terms of contribution to well-being of citizens, as well as to the economy of the creative and cultural sector, there is no way to move in the direction of a major recognition of the work of the individual cultural professional. So the purpose of this session is exactly, so there is no need that I explain what is Art Lab, and but what I'm saying explains perfectly why the session that is just now over, your session, fits perfectly into our mission. That's it.
Thank you so much, Hugo. I'm really glad you could join us and articulate so clearly this call for a formal recognition of the value of creative independence. It's interesting to see in the questions a question around how policymakers should select which organisations to support. The questions we haven't really been able to fully answer about are we leaders willing to step aside and hand over power? And also a comment in the chat for picking up Julie's point about institutional mourning and that the traditional agency held by organisations has been nullified, leaving a void. Is there a space there? Is there an opportunity there, as well as for creative independence, as well as all of the challenges we face? I feel this conversation could go on for much, much longer. There's so much more to say. But I want to thank all of the panelists. Please do, if you're happy to, share your email or your website in the chat. There's been a request for that. I hope that for everyone attending and for the panelists, it's given you some food for thought, and that the conversations will continue in the weeks and months to come. I just want to remind you to please be visible, be present yourselves, and by please letting us hear your feedback on the session. The link to do that is in the chat. It really does make a difference if you can spend a few minutes. This conversation about the role of creative independence will continue in the UK and will continue in Italy, and I hope it will be continue between the two countries and more internationally. And the conversation very literally continues through two more cultural salons in the UK-Italy season. So please do join again. You can look on the British Council's website at britishcouncil.it to find all of that information. But for now, thank you to all the panelists. Thanks to the British Council for organising this salon, and thanks to everyone for attending. Goodbye.
Thank you.
Thanks to you, Kate. Thanks, Kate.